Let's begin with a little bit of review of where we were. We had been talking about the structure of Job, and I had indicated to you that I thought that Job was a chiastic text, a chiasmus, which of course is spelled C-H-I-A-M, A-S-M-U-S, chiasmus. So a chiasmus, again, is a text that has this A, B, C, D, C, B, A pattern. Of course, it can be bigger or smaller. The important thing is that it has a pivot text, a central text. It may not be the center in terms of, you know, counting verses, but structurally it is the center. And typically the pivotal text is just that. It is pivotal. It is somehow critically important to the interpretation and the meaning of the text. And so what I suggested to you last time, what we have in the book of Job is essentially wrestling over the issue of theodicy, the righteousness of God, and challenges to the righteousness of God on the basis of what we see in the world, namely that the wicked thrive and prosper, and that, generally speaking, good people often suffer terribly and have horrible things happen to them. The test case is Job, who is a righteous man who fears God and who turns away from evil. And so you have this man, Job, who is suffering severe afflictions, and you have this great debate and discussion over the righteousness of God. And I suggested to you that in the middle of it all, you have this wisdom poem. The wisdom poem is from the narrator. That is to say, it is not spoken by Job or any of the characters. As a number of commentators have observed, it is really thoroughly inconsistent with Job's outlook and with what Job typically says. And there's no indication it's from anyone else. This does come then, I think, pretty clearly from the narrator. Also, it has this kind of, if you will, omniscience about it. The same sort of thing that you see in chapter 1 and 2. The narrator in chapters 1 and 2 knows what is going on in heaven. He knows about a conversation between God and Satan. That's about as knowing as you can get. And so the statement of wisdom is to be taken as axiomatic. It is not subject to challenge, whereas everything Job and the three say is subject to challenge. But what do we have here then in this structure? We have, first of all, especially in this three cycles of debate, a human attempt to solve the problem of evil. Then you have three major speeches from three different perspectives. And of course, this is Job, Elihu, and God. Now, God's is going to be obviously authoritative, and it's something we need to unpack. But the wisdom poem comes before that and is pivotal because it is the wisdom poem that tells us that our knowledge of wisdom is limited. It is an earthbound wisdom that we have. It is, again, the kind of wisdom that you see in Proverbs, in the book of Proverbs. A wisdom that is founded in creation, a wisdom that you can see everywhere, a wisdom that in the personification of Lady Wisdom stands in the street and calls out for people to come to her and is available to one and to all, to anyone who would listen. Whereas the wisdom of Job 28 is completely hidden. No matter how hard you try to find it, no matter how deep you dig, no matter how great your skills, you can't find it. As the text says, only God knows the way to it. So the text speaks of a higher hidden wisdom that is beyond human capacity. And thus it actually paves the way, finally, for God's response in chapters 38 to 41, giving us something of the hidden wisdom, although even there God won't tell us everything. Now, in addition to the wisdom discourse, in addition to this general structural outline, I would also suggest there is another structural element in the book of Job that is pretty important. And the wisdom chapter is part of this as well. I've already alluded to this, but let me bring it out more explicitly here. You have in the book of Job three what I would call revelations. Three revelations. The first revelation is the revelation of the Spirit to Eliphaz. And this is 4, 12 to 21. A spirit who comes in the night and speaks to Eliphaz. The second revelation that we've been talking about is chapter 28, Wisdom, the poem of wisdom. The third revelation, of course, is the great speech of the Lord, chapters 38 to 41. The revelation spoken by the Lord. So, we have in the text of Job these three points at which there is some kind of external, if you will, supernatural piece of information given. The first from a spirit, which we're going to look at in detail a little later, very important passage. The second from wisdom, which basically, or concerning wisdom, which basically speaks of our inability. The third, the thing that sort of clarifies it all, rightly understood, the speech of Yahweh. So again, what I'm suggesting to you is you have within the book of Job the human condition in which you have all this suffering and all this evil in the face of having an omniscient God, an almighty God, and you're trying to come to terms with it. I mean, the problem, I should even back up a little bit and speak to this issue because I really haven't directly addressed it. I think you all understand what it is, and I was kind of assuming that, but let's speak of it clearly. What is the problem of evil? The problem of evil is if God is almighty and all-knowing and righteous, why is there so much suffering? Why is there so much evil? Why is it the case that evil sometimes seems to be triumphant and victorious? That you can have generation after generation of people who are suffering under cruel oppression of powerful people, autocratic governments, with no relief. If God is just and almighty, how is it that terrible tragedies can happen that kill huge numbers of people who in general terms, in human terms, are decent people, but even people who are, for all practical purposes, innocent, like babies? How can that happen? That is the problem of evil. And that is the problem that the book of Job wrestles with. And I guess while I'm on this little thread, I should say a few more words. Remember the pagan wisdom of the Mesopotamian wisdom texts on the sufferer. Things like Ludlul Bel Nemeki, I will praise the Lord of wisdom. When you consider this material, when you look at what they're saying, essentially, the reason people suffer is because of sin. That's what they say. They're pagans. But they basically say people do something wrong. People are essentially sinful creatures. And that's why there's so much suffering. That's exactly what Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar say. They say it pretty radically. Now, why is that important for us to think about? It's important for us to think about because that, in fact, is our immediate answer as well. We say exactly the same thing. People suffer because of sin. They are sinners. Some people will express it a little more crudely than others, some with a little more finesse, but it is a fairly universal assumption of ours. Now, I'm not up here to say that that's wrong. Clearly, the Bible has a great deal to say about the fact that human suffering is rooted deeply in sin, but from the book of Job, what we hear is that is not a sufficient answer. You cannot completely resolve the problem just by saying people are sinners and God is punishing them. There's much more to it than that. A further illustration of just how universal this assumption is, almost how instinctive it is, especially in what we can loosely call religious people, the disciples of Jesus and the man born blind. Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? It's just an assumption. If you have something as terrible happen as being born blind, somebody must have sinned. So was it kind of a preemptive punishment to the man, knowing he would sin? And so he's punished in advance? Or are his parents being punished with a blind son for some sin they committed? Jesus' answer, of course, is neither this man nor his parents, but so that the glory of God might be revealed in him. Now that is a distinctive case of itself, but my point is, our instinctive reaction to the problem of suffering and pain is to always attribute it to the fact that people are sinners, and there's more to it than that. Again, I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm saying there's more to it than that. But if you say that is the answer, period, you're going to go down the route of the three friends. And if you follow the route of the three friends, in fact, we are going to walk with the three friends as they go through their kind of spiritual descent, and we see where they end up, which is essentially filled with hatred and bitterness and false judgment. That's the demise of the friends. And that's where it ever ends up if you follow that path. So the book of Job is very, very profound as it deals with the problem of evil. But now to get back on track to where I was, in the book of Job, you have people wrestling with the problem of evil from human perspective. But within that, you have these three revelatory moments: the spirit to Eliphaz, the poem about wisdom, and the speech of the Lord. And that will, of course, be very, very important. All right, now we're still in introductory matter, so I want to talk to you a little bit about the text of the book of Job and questions that have been raised about the unity of the book of Job. A very common view is that the prologue and the epilogue are from a different hand. Some will say that the prologue and epilogue were written first, that maybe it was an old legend that eventually was committed to writing, and you had this little short story. Or maybe the dialogues were written first, and somebody came along and said, well, this needs an introduction and a conclusion. And so they wrote the prologue and the epilogue. The essential evidence in favor of it is the fact that the prologue and epilogue are written in prose, just very plain, simple prose, whereas everything else from chapters 3 to 41 is in a very high level of poetry. the only other poetry in the Old Testament that is of such a high level as Job is Song of Songs. So you've got this very high level of poetry bounded on either side by a very straightforward, simple prose. So some people will say, well, the narrative style is so different that they must have come from two different authors. I certainly don't think we need to go this route. First of all, the combining of prose and poetry in a single text is by no means unusual in the ancient Near East. It happens frequently. It is not strange. It is not unusual. So just as a literary matter, it's not at all peculiar. Secondly, the poetry by itself really makes no sense. I mean, if you started the book of Job at chapter 3, you wouldn't know what was going on. You would just be able to eventually surmise, okay, Job is somehow suffering and his friends are arguing with him, but you really wouldn't have any context at all for the poetry and you'd be really bewildered. Also, the way the poem ends with God's speech, you kind of would feel it's not finished. If you had only the prose, well, the problem would be that the prose would be inconsistent. In the prologue, you have Satan and God. In the epilogue, in the conclusion, Satan's not present. So you figure, how did the story end and there's no reference to Satan? Also, in the epilogue, you have reference to the friends and God's punishment to the friends, a warning of punishment, and Job needing to intercede for them. If you don't have the poems, you don't have any idea why that happened. The last thing the prologue says about the friends is they came to comfort Job. And then suddenly in the epilogue, God is saying, now, unless Job prays for you, you're going to be punished severely. So it doesn't make any sense. So basically, the book is incoherent and incomplete, I think, without both the poetry and the prose. And so I think it is a unified text in that regard. Another area of dispute are the Elihu speeches. Now, Elihu, again, he appears, as you know, in chapters 32 to 37. We're going to look at him in some detail in a little while. But the problem with the Elihu speeches is he shows up out of nowhere. He is never mentioned in the prologue or in any of the poetic speeches. And you come through all the poetic speeches and all their debate and all the their disagreement. And Job finishes his final speech and all of a sudden there's this guy Elihu there. And you don't know where he came from. What's more, no one pays attention to him. Job doesn't respond to him. The three friends don't respond to him. God doesn't respond to him. So he's really like he is not there. Another thing people have noticed, if you've done your reading in the Anderson commentary, he talks about this, is Elihu does clearly seem to reflect upon all the speeches that went before. He's aware of them. He refers to them very explicitly. And that's quite distinctive. So you have a character show up who's never introduced anywhere else, who is ignored by all the characters, who is aware of everything that went on before, and so people will argue this is a secondary insertion. Some later author came along and inserted the speech of Elihu. Well, the question would be, why did he do it? The most common answer, I think, that would be given is that it is basically just the same as you see in the introduction to Elihu. He heard the speeches of the three that they tried to condemn Job but failed, And he read the words of Job and he found them alarming, or he heard the words of Job and he found them alarming. And he wanted to correct that so that some pious writer, having read the book of Job without the Elihu speeches, thought, well, this is just not right. I can improve on this. And so he inserted the speech of Job, of Elihu, to kind of give the correct theology, to give a correction both to Job and to the three friends, and to resolve the problem of evil. And as I said, we're going to look at Elihu in great detail in a little while. Oh, go ahead.
So in the epilogue, when God said to Job, pray for your three friends, Elihu was not included.
No, Elihu is not mentioned one way or the other. Nothing is said about him. A problem with reading Elihu as a secondary insertion is this. He comes across as so brash and arrogant. He says of himself, one who is perfect in knowledge is among you. That's generally not how you want to portray a wise, devout person in biblical literature. And so the fact that he comes across as so brash, as so certain of himself, as so arrogant, has led people to think, well, it can't possibly be like a secondary insertion, you know, unless the author of the insertion was himself really brash and really arrogant, and he thought he was perfect in knowledge. We're going to look at the Elihu speeches, as I said, in detail in a while, once we finally get to that point. But I want to say this. I think the Elihu speeches are integral to the book of Job. They're part of the original book of Job. They have an important function. But it is a very surprising function. In my interpretation, as I understand Elihu, he has a function which is critically important, but I think very, very surprising. Not at all what you would expect to find. So I'll just kind of leave that at that point. The other big question about the book of Job concerns the third cycle of speeches. It has to do with the fact that in the first two cycles you have the pattern of Eliphaz speaks, Job answers, Bildad speaks, Job answers, Zophar speaks, Job answers. That happens twice. In the third cycle, Zophar doesn't speak at all. You just have Eliphaz and Bildad. What's more, in Job's answer, which is Job 26:27, in Job's answer, he comes across at parts of those chapters sounding very much like the friends. He is talking about the majesty and power of God. He's talking about how God punishes the wicked, all this kind of stuff, so that Job really sounds like the three friends. So people have said, well, it looks like the text has suffered some dislocation. In other words, part of what is represented as Job's speech probably really belongs to Zophar. So that somehow the text got corrupted, some lines got lost, some introductory material was lost, and so there should be a Zophar speech in there, but because maybe an introductory line somehow got lost in the textual transmission, it's gone. And now you have these words that sound so much like the arguments of the three friends being attributed to Job. Now, a standard kind of apologetic or answer to that argument is that Job at this point knows the arguments of the three friends so well that he can parrot them, that he is kind of making the arguments for them. This argument is made in not only evangelical commentaries, but some critical commentaries, some critical commentators. don't really think that the text is corrupted at this point. For example, Sal's commentary. And so he argues just what I said, that Job knows the speeches of the three so well that he's kind of parroting the speech. Maybe he's being a little sarcastic, but he's in effect making their speech for them. I don't think the text has suffered any dislocation. I don't think it's corrupted. I don't think we need to take part of the speech from Job and reascribe it to Zophar or anything like that. But I don't think that's an adequate argument. I think there's more to it than just that Job knows their argument and he's parroting it. But again, when we get to that point, I'll talk about what I think Job is really doing. But I don't want to really get into that at this point. So, to summarize, what we have in terms of the integrity of the book of Job, the questions we have are threefold. I guess I should write these down. Question number one, the prologue and epilogue. Were they originally separate from the poetry? My basic argument is neither the poetry nor the prose makes sense by itself. Both have to have the other in order to be comprehensible. Also, again, there's nothing unusual about a text that has both prose and poetry. The second major consideration, now I just suddenly had a mental block here, it's early in the morning. The Elihu speeches. Are the Elihu speeches written as a secondary insertion, probably by a pious reader who thought that the book of Job just hasn't adequately answered the questions, and so he has to put this material in? As I said, I think the Elihu speeches serve a very important function. I do not think that they are secondary, and what they do we will get into. But I think, despite the fact that Elihu comes across as completely sort of outside the picture, that these chapters are essential to the book of Job, that you really... You don't get the full message of the book of Job unless you have the Elihu chapters. But I'll explain why, and as I say, I think it's... If my interpretation is correct, it's a pretty surprising use that we find in the book of Job. The third issue is the missing Zophar in the third speech. What happened to Zophar? Now, again, the basic issue is that Job in chapters 26, 27 sounds at points like the three friends, especially, I should say, 27, 13 to 23. And Job's speech is often attributed to Zophar. The kind of apologetic answer is that Job knows their material so well, he's parroting it. I think this material is integral to the book of Job, but I think that answer is not quite adequate. I think there's more to it than that, which we'll have to get into when we get there. So, to summarize, I think we should just take the book of Job as we have it. I should say one more word about a textual matter, that is the Septuagint, the Greek Septuagint. It is quite different in many points from the Hebrew text. There are many places where the Septuagint will diverge from the Hebrew text. I think this is probably just the fact, primarily, that the Hebrew text, the poetry of the Hebrew text, is a very high level of poetry and at times is difficult. Is to translate. It's obscure. It's hard to understand. And the Septuagint of Job, I think, is to some degree paraphrastic. He's trying to give what to him is a sensible translation. He's kind of summarized at some points. He's simplified. He's taken some a little bit of wild guess here and there. I don't think the Septuagint of the book of Job is evidence for a separate Ur text. You know what I mean by Ur text? That's like the original Hebrew, that you have these two separate Hebrew traditions, one that has come down to us in the Masoretic text, which we have received, and another separate Hebrew text which lies behind the Septuagint. I don't think that's the case. I think the problems in the Septuagint, or these differences in the Septuagint, are purely Septuagintal matters. I don't think it has to do with an original or text. So to summarize my view of the text, we should just take the Masoretic text as it is. There are difficulties, there are things we have to really struggle to interpret, but that's the text we have, and that's the text we should use. And I think trying to reconstruct Job by cutting out the prose, or by rearranging Zophar, or cutting out Elihu, or something like that, is misguided. So, what we're going to do this next is get into the theology of the book. Theology of the book of Job, and we're going to begin with the premise and intellectual setting of Job. Now, many readers of Job, as you come to this text, will adopt, whether they are pious or critical readers, whether you come to it as an evangelical or as a critical scholar, whatever, you will regard the wager between Satan and God as the real explanation of Job's sufferings. I mean, that's what the text says in chapter 1 and 2, so it seems, that the whole reason Job is suffering is because of Satan's wager. There's a problem with that interpretation. Chapter 1, Satan comes up to God and says, well, does Job fear you for nothing? Take away all his possessions, he will curse you to your face. God says, okay, take away his possessions, but don't touch his body. So Job loses everything he has, his children, his wealth, but he doesn't curse God. Chapter 2, Satan comes back to God and says, well, a man can handle that, but take away his health, touch his physical body, and he will curse you to your face. God says, okay, you can harm his body, but don't kill him. So Job suffers excruciating pain with some kind of skin condition, probably boils. He is in agony. He's in horrible pain. And even his wife comes to him and says, curse God and die. Why is she there, by the way? People often raise the question, why does she appear at this one point in the book to say, curse God and die? I think the reason is to say that even the people who are closest to Job are saying, give it up. It's hopeless. It's a way of saying Job has every conceivable external motivation to curse God. He's lost all his possessions. All his children have been violently killed. He is in horrible agony. And his wife, we're not to assume that, you know, like she's a bitter woman, or she hates him, or she wants him to fail or something like that. I think she's to be understood as the person who is most intimate with him, who cares most about him, who sees him in horrible suffering and says, Job, give it up. All you're going to do is lie here and bleed and suffer. Just end it. Curse God and die. And so, He has every conceivable reason, humanly speaking, to curse God, and he does not. He says, you're speaking like one of the foolish women. Shall we receive good from the hand of the Lord and not receive evil also? In all this, Job did no evil with his mouth. What's happened there? The contest is over. Job has won, or God has won. Why doesn't the book end right there? Why does he continue to suffer and suffer? His friends come, they sit for 7 days while he is just languishing in pain. And then the big speeches begin. So why, after Job has passed the test, does it go on? Well, I would suggest that there's really a deeper reason than Satan's challenge. You know, we have spoken of the wisdom of God that is hidden to man. Well, it's hidden to Satan also. Satan doesn't himself really know what God is doing in all of this. So the first thing I would say to you is, if you think that Satan's challenge is kind of the whole answer to the book, I don't think that's right, in my opinion. Well, why is it there? You say, well, that was kind of the initiating event. Yeah, it's the initiating event, but I think there's more to it than that. And that gets to the premise of the book of Job. This is the most important thing I'm going to say in this whole class. The premise of the book of Job, I'll build it up, is something that if you do not accept, you will never understand Job correctly, I think. If you do not accept this premise, you might as well cut the book out of your Bible and never read it. The premise is that he is righteous. He is a righteous man. The book begins with the narrator telling us there was a man who, the land of Uz, who feared God and turned away from evil. Satan comes before God, and God himself says, "Have you considered my servant Job, a man who fears God and turns away from evil?" Satan says, well, maybe it's just because you're protecting him. Maybe he doesn't have any real, what we would call, heartfelt love for you at all. He just knows it's a good deal for him. Take away all his possessions, he'll curse you to your face. Or then take away his health, he'll curse you to your face. God says, go ahead. What does the trial of chapters 1 and 2 establish? It establishes that Job is really, really righteous. He is righteous from the heart. You can take away his possessions. You can kill his children. You can cover his body with boils. You can have the people most intimate with him telling him to curse God and die, and he will not do it. So Job is righteous. Now, we understand that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That is a true doctrine. It's absolutely correct. I accept it. But when you're reading the book of Job, just take it on its own terms. Yesterday, as I began the class, I said, if you're going to understand the book of Job, just take it on its own terms. It will surprise you. It will say things that will trouble you. It will say things that you have to work through and really think through. How do we explain the righteousness of Job? Well, you can explain it as you wish. You can say, maybe, well, he really had some sin, but for the purpose of this book, all that's been kind of airbrushed out. I don't know. But you have to accept the premise that he is suffering entirely because of his righteousness. I have heard famous names I could name that you will recognize immediately, evangelical teachers, say, well, you know, even Job had his dark side. God had to kind of deal with him, you know, to kind of clean out the hidden sins and all that sort of thing, which is exactly what the three friends say. The premise of chapters 1 and 2 is no. There's no hidden sin there. There's no dark secret. He is righteous to the core. He will take everything you can throw at him, and he will hold on to his fidelity to God. He will not curse God. So this is a stunning and powerful thing, but for the purposes of this book, it is extremely important because it takes the quick and easy answer out of the equation. The quick and easy answer is, well, Job, you know, he wasn't perfect. He had some sins. There were things he'd done wrong, or maybe he had some tendencies that he would sin in the future, and God had to deal with these little sinful tendencies. And the text is saying that is not the reason for Job's suffering. And if you use that explanation, again, I will say, you're following the path of the three. And you'll end up where they end up. So that is the premise of the book. Everything follows from that. Because as I've said, all of us, even in the pagan literature, the disciples talking to Jesus about the man born blind, we all have this basic innate response that if someone is suffering, they're suffering because they did something wrong. And that is the explanation for the problem of pain. And the book of Job sets this man up and says, here's a case where that does not apply. And you still have suffering, and you still have to figure it out. The righteousness, as I said, sets up the problem of the book, the problem of theodicy. And it is a crisis for the reader and for the three friends, and for Job himself, in fact. Job and the three come into the book as sages. All four of them are sages. They're wise men. Meaning they hold fast to the traditional wisdom they have received, which is understood to be a valid and good wisdom. But at the core of the wisdom they have received is what we could call the doctrine of cosmic justice, which is very simply stated, God punishes those who do wrong, God helps those who do right. So you've got God punishing wherever there's sin, you've got God protecting and rewarding wherever there's righteousness. And that sets everything in balance. That keeps their whole world comprehensible. Because what I'm calling the doctrine of cosmic justice, it allows the three friends, and initially Job himself, to make sense of what they're seeing in the world. They see suffering. They see, you know, a good woman giving birth to a stillborn child. They see a promising young man who is striving hard to be virtuous, and he's obedient to his parents, and he's trying to avoid vices, suddenly being struck down with a disease for no apparent reason and dying. They see people who are wicked and cruel and godless amassing wealth and living in prosperity and apparently having nothing come wrong to them, nothing go wrong in their lives. They see all that. But they say, well, still, the fact is, God punishes the wicked, he rewards the righteous. That's just the way it is. That explains everything. Even when I don't want to, acknowledge or deal with these anomalies, these problems, all the suffering and all the pain and all the death in the world makes sense because I can explain it by God punishing the wicked and preserving the righteous. And the book of Job, just the case of Job, a righteous man who is suffering terribly, basically says it doesn't work. That answer is not adequate. Why do Job and his friends so violently and angrily fight with Job? And why do they go into a spiritual nosedive, a spiritual descent, so they become more and more bitter against Job? Well, the reason is, I believe, their world is being shattered. Everything that they hold to as true is coming undone. And if you've got someone who is undoing your worldview, who is stubbornly refusing to listen to your arguments, and you cannot refute him, then you start to get angry, and you start to be bitter, and you start to taking it out on him personally. And that's what happens with the three. It's not, you know, it's not that they came to him in order to afflict him. It's that they came to him, chapter 2 tells us, to comfort him. But when he refused to confess some hidden sin, and their entire worldview was in danger of utter collapse, they responded with increasing bitterness and hatred and hostility. Well, with that as an introduction, let's quickly go through chapter 1 and 2. So, open your Bible or turn to it in your notebook, your laptop, and we'll quickly look at Job 1 and 2. I pretty well made all my points, but I'm just going to quickly look at the text and let us think about a few things here and there. The book begins, "There was a man in the land of Uz, as I said, who his name was Job. The man was blameless and upright. He feared God and turned from evil. He has 7 sons and 3 daughters." As we've talked about, Job uses these numbers that are so significant in apocalyptic literature. I think, you know, basically 10 children, 7 and 3, it means a complete full family, as full a family as you could want. 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, many servants. And this is phenomenally wealthy. Any understanding that the average shepherd would have, you know, a handful of sheep or goats, you know, enough that he could count easily, 10, 15, 20, somebody having them in the thousands. So this man would be phenomenally wealthy. Not only that he had an extreme piety. Because he was so wealthy, verse 4 tells us that his sons would hold feasts in their houses, and they would send to their sisters and invite them to come, so they would have, you know, these kind of parties. But Job would think, well, possibly they did something wrong. Maybe they got a little loose in their talk. Maybe they cursed God. So he would offer all of these sacrifices in their behalf, in behalf of his children, in order to appease God, because he's so concerned to maintain proper relations with God. Satan comes before God, and God says to Satan, "From where have you come?" And Satan says, "From going to and fro on the earth, walking up and down on it." Question, why is Satan walking up and down on the earth? Why is he going to and fro? I'm sorry? Okay, to devour. Peter uses that. In the context of Job, you know, devour in a sense is correct, but I think it's a little more specific than that. I'm sorry? Because he's cursed? Well, that could be, but he's under a curse, and therefore he's wandering to and fro. But I think, again, in context, there's a more specific reason. What is he doing? Looking for people, specifically for what purpose? To accuse. What does he do here? He accuses. Satan is the accuser. His primary function is to point out human guilt, which is an interesting thing. This is a little sidebar. But again, what do the three friends forcefully try to show? That Job is a sinner. They try to find guilt. Focusing on the guilt of people is a satanic tendency. We sometimes think of it as a righteous tendency, you know, I fear God and therefore I notice other people don't. And we think of that as sort of our righteousness. But the tendency to judge, to look for evil in others, is a satanic tendency. In Satan's case, he specifically does it to accuse. Now, I mentioned this text before and mentioned Revelation a great deal in my previous, yesterday's lecture. But let's quickly look at Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12 is, of course, the conflict involving the dragon, his war in heaven and being cast down, and then pursuing the woman and the rest of her offspring. But look what it says about the great dragon in chapter 12, verse 7 of Revelation. Now war arose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. Pause right there. What do we tend to think of this as? Well, we take it very literally. Well, this is war, you know. Angels and demons duking it out, you know, kind of like Paradise Lost. They're firing cannons at each other, and they're swinging swords at each other, and it's just combat. But verse 9 says, the great dragon was thrown down, the ancient serpent who's called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ has come, for the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even to death. In what capacity was the dragon in heaven? He was in heaven as the accuser of our brothers. What really cast the dragon out of heaven? The blood of Christ. Atonement for sin. He no longer has grounds to accuse them. So you have this image of warfare in heaven, but what it's really talking about is the essential function of Satan. His essential identity is to attribute guilt to people. And now that has been taken away, and he who accused them day and night before God is cast out. What does he do in Job? He stands up before God and he accuses. So just as a little sidebar, you have there the work of Christ as the foundation for the destruction of the work of Satan, for his work as an accuser. Here in Job, he is accusing. He is going to and fro looking for people. God says, verse 8, Job 1:8, have you considered my servant Job? God knows who Satan is looking for. He's looking for people to accuse. And God says, well, if you're looking for people, take a look at Job. God says, have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. As I just indicated, notice he repeats verbatim what the narrator says in verse 1. Blameless and upright, fears God, turns from evil. So God himself testifies to Job, this is a righteous man. Verse 9, Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he has on every side? Bless the work of his hands, his possessions have increased in the land. Well, first of all, get the nature of Satan's accusation. He uses the metaphor of a hedge. Of course, a hedgerow serves essentially as a fence. In countries and places where hedgerows are used, a farmer will plant a big row of a very thorny bush that will get very large and very thick, impenetrable, thorns all over it. You can't get through it. And the hedgerow will protect his property, keep his livestock in, and keep intruders out. This is a very effective fence. And what Satan is saying, you've put a hedgerow all the way around his property. Nothing can touch him. Nothing can get near him. He suffers nothing. So, you know, if you want to kind of unpack the metaphor a little bit, disease doesn't touch him. Poverty doesn't touch him. There's no storm that comes through and destroys his property. No bandits touch him. Nothing. From every conceivable direction, he is safe. Not only is that, but you bless the work of his hands, which means every business endeavor he gets into. If he invests money, we'll put it in modern terms, if he invests money in Microsoft, Microsoft stock will double. You know, wherever, whatever he touches, it works. It succeeds. No wonder he fears you. What a great deal. You have blessed everything he does. But Satan says, take all that he has, he will curse you to your face. So basically Satan says he's only in it for the money. Okay? So as we know, God says, go ahead and do it. Only don't touch his body. Don't hurt him physically. And then you have these horrible series of events that all strike him in a single day. Verse 13, his sons and daughters were eating and drinking in their oldest brother's house. Messenger came to Job. The oxen were plowing, the donkeys feeding beside them. The Sabaeans came and fell upon them, struck them down, struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. I alone have escaped to tell you. So a bunch of Sabaeans come up from Arabia and they just take all the livestock and slaughter all the servants who are with them. While that's happening, fire falls from heaven. Verse 16. And burns up the sheep and the servants who are with them. Well, fire from heaven, you know, that can't be explained as bad luck. You know, that is like being directly afflicted by God. Understand, of course, ultimately God is in control, notwithstanding Satan. But in other words, it cannot be afflicted to natural attributed to natural causes. Verse 17, the Chaldeans formed three groups, made a raid on the camels, took them, struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. I alone have come to tell you. So the Chaldeans, probably from the Mesopotamian area, came and took them. So they're coming from all over the place, all these different groups. They're taking everything. Verse 19, a great wind came across the wilderness, struck the four corners of the house, fell upon the young people. They are dead. So all your kids are dead. And how did they die? They died by a great whirlwind. And again, even though a whirlwind is not of itself miraculous, it would be treated as an act of God, right? Job's famous response in verse 21, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, naked shall I return. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." And all this, the Lord did not sin or charge God with any wrong. So he gives a classic statement of complete piety and submission. Everything I had came from God. If God takes it, he's just taking his own. So I'm not going to curse God. Moving on, we come to chapter 2. And again, the angels are there in the court of God, and Satan is there. And Satan, once again, has been going to and fro. Once again, God says, "Have you considered Job? There's none like him. Blameless and upright, fears God, turns from evil. Even though you incited me against him to destroy him without reason." Notice, from where did these disasters really come? From God. Satan didn't send the fire from heaven. God did. So the disasters came from God. Verse 4, Satan answered, "Skin for skin." What does that mean? What does skin for skin mean? That's not a rhetorical question. I'm wondering if someone will tell me. What does skin for skin mean? The answer is, I don't know. No one knows, but I'll give you my guess. Well, first of all, it probably was some common idiom that people would use that was understood back then but has since been lost. The closest analogy we have is the famous, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, a life for a life. The point of an eye for an eye is there is nothing equivalent to an eye. If you gouge out a man's eye, the only punishment that can match it exactly is to gouge out your eye. If you knock out a man's tooth, the only punishment that can match it exactly is to knock out your tooth. There is no equivalent to an eye. There is no equivalent to a tooth. What amount of money corresponds to an eye? Or for what that matter, what amount of money corresponds to a life? So when Satan says skin for skin, I think what he's saying is there anything that can correspond in value to your own skin, your own hide, your own body? There is nothing you value like your body. There's nothing you could give in exchange for it. There's no amount of money a person could give to kind of sell it. It is irreplaceably valuable. It is the self. So when Satan says skin for skin, my guess is he means all we've touched so far are things that are just external to him, that he's prepared to let go of. Touch something that is of himself, and he won't let go of that willingly at all. So he says, all the man has he will give for his own life. Stretch out your hand, touch his bone and flesh, and he will curse you to your face. And so God says, okay, he's in your hand, but spare his life. In this case, it does say Satan himself did afflict Job. Verse 7, Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Of course, in the ancient Near East, remember, commonly, personal disease is attributed to demons. And of course, you have demon possession and disease in the ministry of Jesus, where in certain cases, a person will be physically afflicted, but it will be a demon possession. So the idea of physical affliction being the result of demonic activity is not unusual. But again, it is still under God's control. God is the one who's, in a sense, pulling all the strings. So we've already observed that his wife says, curse God and die. And I have argued with you that that is to make the point that Job has every conceivable reason to give up. But his answer is, you speak as one of the foolish women. Shall we receive from God and not receive good from God and not receive evil? In all this, he did not sin with his lips. So as I have suggested, I believe that Job has passed the test right there. And in that sense, the book could have ended right there. But it didn't, because it's not just about Satan. It's not about Satan's accusation. It is about the larger matter of the nature of suffering, the purpose of suffering, the righteousness of God, and purposes that Satan himself has no understanding of, and the book goes on. So we come to chapter 2, verse 11. Now when Job's three friends heard of this evil that came upon him, they came each from his own place, Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, Zophar the Naamathite. They made an appointment together to show up, to show him sympathy and comfort. And when they saw him from a distance, they didn't recognize him. They raised their voices and wept. They tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads toward heaven. They sat down with him on the ground 7 days and seven nights. No one spoke a word to him, for they saw his suffering was very great. What do you make of the portrayal of the friends in this introduction? How are they portrayed?
I mean, you could see from that text that Job's suffering was really severe. They could have even recognized him.
Okay, the text tells us the suffering was so severe they couldn't recognize him. They came basically with great compassion. They don't come to afflict him. They don't come to torment him. They don't come to point fingers and say, aha, Job, what did you do wrong? They, in fact, show tremendous sympathy and love for him. They journey to come together to comfort him. When they see him, they weep and they mourn and they throw dust on their heads and they rip their clothing. And they just sit there in silence. You know, it's kind of like a long hospital visit for 7 days. So the idea is they have come with the purest of motives. Once Job begins to speak and they begin to respond, things will go south fast. And just a moment. The importance of this is to understand, I think the author is showing us how their commitment to their answer to the problem of evil when it was not accepted, when this living, breathing refutation to them was just sitting there and would not accept their arguments, they became progressively hostile and mean and bitter. And the point that the text is making is this is where their theology leads. And so it serves as a warning to us. Go ahead.
One question going back a couple of sentences. If Job is not about suffering so much, well, Job is about suffering and God's righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Also Job's righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
What does it say about saving faith?
Saving faith is an issue I think that we will see becomes more and more prominent in the book of Job, especially in Job's speeches up through chapter 27. So that's something that will progress in Job, an awareness of the need for saving faith and the need for grace, but that's something we'll work through.
So separate to that is the three friends, sages' righteousness, mm-hmm. which is different to Job's idea, because all they can draw on is their own world.
Yeah, I think the question is, the friends' righteousness separate from Job's righteousness? In a sense, yes. But I think in a real sense, Job and the three begin with the same premise. Job also holds to what I'm calling the doctrine of cosmic justice. The difference is the three friends said Job must be guilty. If he's not guilty, our doctrine collapses. And so that's what makes him so angry. Job holds to the same doctrine, but he says, look, I'm not guilty. And that's what makes Job's, that's what makes Job kind of rage and try to find an answer, because he starts from the same presupposition, but he will not confess to a sin he hasn't committed in order just to maintain the doctrine. He does. And we will see that Job has a much closer relationship with God as we go through the dialogues and the three do.